very large crowd tonight. We're usually used to seeing about two people, maybe. You know, Doug and one other, and that's about it. Typically the public comment period is anything that's not on the agenda for tonight. If there's anything you want to bring up or compliments on something that's going on or any type of discussion like that, this will be the time that we do it. And then we'll, after that, we'll move on to the agenda portion of it. So is there anything that anybody has or wants to share? It's been a couple of weeks, Doug. Do you have anything? All right. Lisa, anything?
Everybody sign in?
Oh, yeah.
There was a sign in. No, they were all signed in.
Okay. Yeah. And then if you haven't, just make sure at some point you don't have to all run up at the same time, but just make sure we get your name on there for the record.
That's a good time, gentlemen.
And then the other thing, too, tonight as it goes, if there is a portion of or a part of the meeting where you're able to just make sure that we introduce ourselves with, you know, who you are. I know a lot of times most of us know a lot of you in here, but not everybody, so just make sure you just get up and introduce yourself. That way Lisa can put you onto the meeting.
It's also hard with masks on.
Yeah. Received the town plan from the planning commission, which we should have gotten a copy of that in our packets.
Yeah, and we put a new copy out online with the edits, so it kind of did it with the so that in words so people could see the edits that were made from the planning commission after their public hearing. Also, so since now that we officially voted the planning commission to move it to the select board, you can see that you have not less than 30 nor more than 120 days after the proposed plan is submitted to the legislative body to hold your first public hearing. So I'm suggesting that you do it November 9th at 6. That gives us time to warn it, because there's obviously statutory, you know, things about warning it. And then you can just do it at 6 o'clock as the first part of your normal select board meeting.
That's our normal meeting? I just checked
it. I believe so.
Am I wrong? 9th?
Yeah.
Great. Oh, what was it? I think it was 6.
I don't know.
Backwards.
So, yeah.
Okay.
So, I was thinking you could just do it at 6 o'clock, you know, to begin your regular meetings. So, obviously, you have a copy of the town plan. Some of you get it electronically, some of you get it paper. But if everybody's good with that, then I will follow these rules. You make sure that you get it in the newspaper, just like you did for the planning commission. And, you know, there's all sorts of statutory stuff we have to do. So, you guys are good with November 9th at 6 o'clock, and that's what we'll
do. Sure. Well, it should be fine.
Excuse me?
Yeah, it should be fine.
Okay.
All right, I have a motion. Motion to set November 9th at 6 o'clock at our normal select board meeting as the item for the Bethel Down Plan.
So moved.
Second.
Favor?
Aye.
Aye.
So is that a meeting unto itself or just?
We'll just make it the first. I'll try to keep the rest of the meeting short.
Yeah. It'll be in budget kind of fine too.
We'll be fine. We're doing October and stuff too, but yeah, maybe that'll be the only other thing we do that night.
Right.
So.
Okay.
Yeah. But hopefully, if there's any questions.
I mean, I wouldn't think it would be quite as long as the last one that we
did. No, we did well the other night, I thought.
Do we need to have it available, you know, on Zoom or anything like that? Or
we don't have to,
it,
no, but we could. It's just a trick because the acoustics in here are so poor.
I know, I sat in on the other one there.
I don't know, it was tough.
It was really tough to hear.
It is because you have people hear you, so it is. It's
any further discussion on the town plan? We started reading it to speaker. Less than we had to do last time when we had the, when we did last time, we had all the river corridor pieces, which was new for not just our town, but the state as a whole. It was a lot of information to take in, so. I found a couple of things interesting in the town plan when I was reading through it. You know, with the survey, I was going through the survey. Did you guys have a chance to look at the survey that was sent out?
Just briefly, I've been.
But I thought it was interesting that most respondents agreed or strongly agreed that the town should, and then they had, you know, five or six different things that the town should be doing. One was obviously promoting business, and then down below was most respondents disagreed or strongly disagreed with the following. It was kind of contradicting each other. Less business. I was like, business or no business? Or there was a piece in there about encouraging retail and small business, but on the other side, prioritizing historic preservation over business development. So I find it a little bit, maybe down the road on the planning commission, maybe clear up those questions a little bit, because they kind of want to show a little bit. Other than that, good information so far.
There's another chair over here if you want.
Great.
Yeah, and you can pull it down through the window if you want to give yourself some more space.
All right, any further discussion on town plan? Okay. And for anybody that hasn't been to a select board meeting before, anyways, when I first started, when I came here and I first started sitting on the board meetings, you know, kind of out in the public, and it was like a whopping, like one or two, three people, same thing. It's just, it's kind of a strange thing because it's really a meeting of the board members. So it's kind of like almost like a little private meeting of five or six people, but it's done in a public setting. So it's kind of a little weird how the meeting goes. It's, you know, so at times you'll probably see us not really speaking, like checking out. It's more kind of like, in a group setting, talking about the town plan or something like that. So if anybody does want to comment on when we get, sounds like the majority of you came for one piece of it, but when we get to that point, just, you know, be patient with us, put your hand up, try not to talk over people, especially right now with, you know, masks and things like that. It's hard to hear over people. So just put your hand up and I'll recognize you, you know, at some point. We may not be all at the same time. Next up, we had the Two Rivers. We have Two Rivers grant aid, which is a letter that we get once a year from Two Rivers in regards to their grant process.
And we've participated in the past, so we need some signatures. This is more about doing more of those hydraulically connected road segments to bring us into full compliance with the municipal roads general permits. Obviously they're saying they haven't been funded yet by the state, so don't start any construction projects till we get the word, but certainly it does a lot. It's nice, it's culverts, it's stone line ditching and that sort of thing. So we participated in the past. I think last time we got $25,500, so.
We were up there visiting it today.
That's right. So it's a good program to do.
So this application is for money that's not been released yet, or
basically this is just a letter of intent. Yeah,
letter
saying
of intent.
That once it comes out, we want to apply because what we can get is we can get $24,000 for $6,000 of our match.
Right.
So we just need you guys a motion to sign a letter of intent.
Move to sign the letter of intent for TROMC grant and aid program.
Okay.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Is that this is one?
I think it's three songs from the letter.
Thank you. So we have Jean's appointment to the Planning Commission. I'm assuming that's something that Jean wants to do, because here this evening.
Yeah, there's a letter in the packet. And he came to the, who was this for? He even came to the Planning Commission, the public hearing, so, and it was good, had some good insights. So it was good.
Well, I mean, we've talked about it at the meeting, well, it's probably been over a year now, we've been talking about that our committees, after Irene, you know, we saw a resurgence of activities and people wanting to get involved in the community, all the programs and community, you know, committees. And then here in the last couple of years, we're seeing, you know, a lot of that people are leaving these committees, and some, you know, some it's just some people have been on these committees for 20 years or so, which, you know, but a lot of it's just, you know, people that come on for a year and leave. And one thing that, you know, keep Bethel moving forward like we want it to do and continue is really, you know, we have to make sure that our committees are full. Planning Commission is one that we have to have full through the state, but, you know, we have other committees as well that are still struggling. So anybody that's in here tonight, that, you know, it's a little pitch for, you know, the Recreation Committee is always looking for people. Recreation Committee is always looking for people. So Planning Commission is looking for people. DRB.
As I said,
Conservation.
She's pretty well stuck, but we didn't talk about that at the public hearing for the Planning Commission. I said, look, if there's not just one committee, leave town and we'll find one for you. It doesn't work for the first time.
Tom, can I make a suggestion that maybe there could be some kind of public forum held or some informational gathering held, how our town government works, what the select board does, what the commissions do, etc. These are all words, this commission, that commission, but I don't think most of us don't really know what that all involves, how often they meet, that it's a voluntary position, et cetera, how they vote, et cetera. I think that would be maybe informational and encourage young people to come to that to see how it goes and, you know.
Yeah, sure, there's different ways that we can go about doing that. You know, either getting information out there through, you know, social media is the easiest nowadays, or another good one would be talking with our town meeting day committee. You know, that might be something where they could maybe have a little display of how the hierarchy of the government works and how the committees fall into those areas. So, and I think I saw your hand up.
David Fair, owner of Hustle and Loyalty Records. Who runs the rec committee?
Right now, the chair is Emily Berman.
Really?
Do you know her?
She's my neighbor.
No, she's not.
She's my neighbor.
Oh, well, there you go. Yeah, she's currently the chair. She came in to drop off an invitation, I think, for the state.
There should be information on the website in regards to the committees. If you know, if you go on tonight, you want to look up on the website on the committees. It'll usually tell the contact person for that.
And I know she's really looking for people, David.
Yes, sir.
I'm Dana Kolobak. Just refer the gentleman here to the operating manual, the well-done piece of information that's online and tells you all about what's going on. And I encourage him to take a look at it. It explains committee structure, what you guys do.
And if you didn't get it, if you didn't get the owner's operating manual card, I believe you have.
There's some on the website, and we have like 4,000 in the office.
Yeah, we have some in the office.
There's 4,000.
That's a great resource.
Yes.
Well, I think it's a great idea, and we got that too, and I flipped through it, but I think most of us who don't have a whole amount of time to sit down and read this whole manual from front to back, especially young, I'm talking about younger people. I think we're all in agreement that we want younger people here involved as well. I think for them, there needs to be done something a little more that's a little more involved and maybe a little more personal.
That's a good idea, maybe a Zoom meeting.
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah, I like that idea. Thank you.
one of the things in our current social historical situation that triggered me is the impact of the COVID crisis and what that has meant in terms of the need for different kinds of infrastructure that we have thought than we have previously thought was necessary. I'm speaking specifically about broadband, but the whole notion of the economy and education and so on, that prompted me in part to say the planning, the town plan needs to really need some help in looking at that, and that was part of my motivation.
Yep, and that's the idea behind the town plan. The world in which we live in is ever evolving, so
right.
That's why you don't just have one town plan and just let it roll. I mean, every so many years you have to put together a town plan. You usually start working on it in year three, and then by year five you implement it. Because the world changes so fast, you know. Things like, can you imagine if, let's say we were still on dial-up, can you imagine doing the Zoom meetings on dial-up? That would have never happened, right? It would crash the whole server. But there are things like that. We talked about, with the Energy Committee and, things on electric vehicles and solar panels for homes. You know, there's a lot of things that are changing, and it's good to get, new perspectives on there as well, so.
I've had a couple conversations too with EC Fiber and really to try to see how fast they can get lines in and to expand and that sort of thing, and gotten people to contact them to sign up to have the surveys done. That way when they get to your area, you can just sign right up. And so, but we should definitely put some more information about that, I think, in the town.
And our town, plan is just one part of a regional town plan.
Right.
I'm the Bethel's representative on the Two Rivers Commission. So our town plan is critical to town of Bethel, but it also is linked integrally with all of
the
surrounding towns
well.
That are in the Two Rivers region. There are 31 or 32 towns that are involved in setting up town plans, and they're all linked together, so it's not just us, it also has to relate to all the other towns around us.
I just want to say that today is different than 3 years ago.
Yep.
2 years.
Yes.
I'm sitting at home. I'd like to sort of tack on to what Jean is saying. I've been organizing for Bethel Vermont Strong since April. And the number of people who have interest in being involved and engaged in this community is phenomenal. That was my experience, and I've never served on a board or a commission, but I am energized to think that there's a potential out there, not just during a crisis, but the energy is out there, and there are ways to get people engaged, and I am committed more than ever to working with the town and figuring out the best way to, whether it's an informational meeting, whether it's actually tapping people, understanding what their strengths and interests are. It's a real personal thing to say I'll serve on a board or a commission, and it's not just try this one, try that one. It's what's the talent out there? What's the interest? And matching that up with what the need is. So, Jean, I support what you're saying. It's a different world. But in the world that we're in, the response has been phenomenal.
I will also say there were several community leaders that asked me if I might be interested in serving on something. So there was that.
It's a personal thing.
Personal. Anyway.
So we'll just need a motion to appoint Jean Krupps as 3-year term for Planning Commission.
So move.
Second.
Okay, all in favor?
right?
Aye.
And we'll get something out there in regards to the committees. And I mean, the number one reason why, well, when you ask somebody to be on a committee, they say, oh, I don't have time. You know, it's always, I don't have time. I'm sure if it means a lot to you, you'll find time. But, I mean, I can't tell you that it's only going to take you one meeting a month because, you know, we meet twice a month, but you're kind of always doing something in regards to select board. And then the same thing with, like, the committees. You know, most committees meet once a month. You know, it's for an hour or two in an evening. But you're kind of always kind of doing something with that. You know, what if that's working on your town plan behind the scenes or, you know, recreation, doing something, you know, on that, or might have activities or, you know, you're kind of always doing something. But, I mean, trust me, there's time out there. We, you know.
All of our committees are open for, they're open meetings. So if anybody's interested, just go and sit in on the meetings.
Yeah, or you can just go and visit them.
See if it's interesting.
And they all listed on the website?
Yep, all the meeting locations and times are on there, yep.
Yeah, they're all subject to open meeting law, so they have to be posted a certain number of days in advance. And
it's a good way to find out if you really want to sit on that committee.
Yep.
Sounds like Mo's looking for another committee. All right, so move on.
Thank you, Gene.
Thanks, Gene. Mm-hmm. Carol's not here tonight.
No, he just submitted his letter.
So as we know, Carol is a man of many ball caps in this town, and he's probably more and more caps than anybody else in this town at some point, and he's trying to hand those off to others now in certain capacities. So Carol was looking, Carol was resigning on his place on the South Burlington Senior Center Board, but he also wanted to appoint Paul Baylor, to take over for him for a term of 1 year, so.
And I thought that was pretty great. He resigned and found his replacement. I mean, okay, you know. So I put in his two separate motions, so obviously you want to accept Carol's resignation with regret, and then you could make. I know that Paul didn't submit a letter, but he and Carol already had a conversation about it, so you can either appoint Paul or we can have Kelly send him a letter and ask him to submit a letter of interest. I'm not really sure how you want to do that, but I just was trying to act on Carol Ketchum's wishes. Mm-hmm. But the first one would be obviously the motion to accept it with regret.
So a motion to accept the resignation of Carol Ketchum from the South Burlington Senior Center Board.
So moved, but I'd like to call the board to thank him for the years he's served on this.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. He's given a lot to.
Yeah, it's too bad he didn't come tonight. He didn't come, but. We have a motion.
Second.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
How does the board feel with appointing Paul without a formal letter of request? You know, that's kind of a formality.
Carol talked to him.
Right. Yeah, he did.
So I think it's, I mean, the request would be nice, but,
yeah, but
we could talk about it tonight.
And he said, if you have any questions, please call me, notify me, and Paul of his appointment and his address. And so
I feel comfortable with appointing Paul without. I value Carol's judgment.
And I know the only reason why we went to a formal process was because there were people at times that have been appointed for things and didn't know they were appointed. So we want to make sure that we don't, you know, we come away with those from town meeting day and all of a sudden somebody figured out that they're doing a duty now that they hadn't signed up for. So.
Right, and Kelly will send them a letter just like.
So do I hear a motion to appoint Paul Baylor to the South Burlington Senior Center Board for a term of 1 year?
So move.
Second.
Okay, second. All in favor?
Aye. I would just want to check with Paul. I mean, I trust Carol's judgment and everything, too.
Yeah, just, he'll call it a letter.
You know, okay. We've kind of established the a method to do these just to be sure, so it'd be good to just follow up with him.
Kelly sends him a letter.
I mean, I know Paul, he's my neighbor, I'm sure it's fine.
Alright, and then we have the discussion on the structural engineering responses for RFP. That's for starting the first process of, you know, what can we do with our existing highway department building and land there, anything there, we've moved a bunch of proposals in there. Hopefully Teresa's taking the time to go for professionals. I would say they're all, I've dealt with all but one at one point, but they're all pretty reputable companies. I think the only thing going through there, when I was looking at it, was, there was a combination of, there was a lot of different services for different.
Yeah.
So trying to put apples to apples, and it was.
Yeah, that was DPI.
I was trying to follow what we were looking for baseline versus all these add-ins.
Well, DPI is high, I took them out of the mix anyways, but I read all the proposals and was obviously DuBois and King comes in at 2,000. Then they offer an add-on, which we don't, this alternate add-on of working with this guy, never heard of, but we wouldn't need to do that anyways because that's what a design builder would do. McLaren is a little better at 1,900, and then DuBois and King is at 2,000, and then Child Engineering is at 3,500. You could also see the letter that I also got from Carl. He sent me a bunch of information, and I've worked with Carl before, and I felt like after comparing the three plans, which were really the three that stuck out, were DuBois and King, McLaren, and Child Engineering. I actually would prefer to deal with Child Engineering. I felt like we were going to get more response. McLaren is obviously very basic, DuBois and King as well, but if you looked at Carl's, he had some really good points on here about things that he was going to do. And working with Carl before, he's very thorough. I mean, he already wrote me a letter in advance to tell me about the plans, to tell me, what building it would have been, who would have done it. I mean, so he obviously does his work. I also like the idea that his fee was based on the following assumptions, and one of them is that, although that the live over the roof was below the 42 PSF, pounds per square foot for snow load, there's also exceptions for existing buildings which may apply, and I will spend time looking into those. And, he also was doing a stamped, if you look at his scope of services, he was doing a, obviously reviewing the current building code requirements and comparing it to the design loads. He was also preparing a stamped written report on the feasibility of reusing the existing strain, and load limiting our mezzanine. And I just think that it's a little bit extra money, but I think that we're going to get more information, and it's just going to be, I just think we're going to get more information. And obviously the select board has the right to not pick a little bidder, and I've read them all, and that's my opinion.
So this is Child Engineering?
Yes.
You're talking about? And he was at...
I just have one quick question. What does RFP stand for?
Request for proposal.
Okay.
I'm sorry, yeah, we're doing the, because we need to evaluate the... What we want to do is I want to strip the outside of the town garage so we don't have to build a new one, and then re-side it, reuse the roof if we can, and new windows and lighting, and try to use the existing. And then there's an old, built in about the 80s, a wooden back piece. I want to take that off and have that be metal, and then maybe an add-on as an additional bay to the left, but leave the existing structure. So I needed a structural engineer to see if that was possible. And so that's what it stands for. I'm sorry, I should have said that.
Thank you.
So he's at 3,500?
He is
not to exceed 3,500?
He's at 3,500, McLaren is at 1,900, and he's at 2,000. Obviously, I realize I'm going to go for a little bigger, but I just feel like we're going to get, by reading the proposals, if you read the proposals and compared them side by side to what you were going to get, I feel like we're going to get a little bit more information, which is what we need, because it's a big deal to throw money in there. So, again, that's my opinion. We certainly can read the proposals and have other opinions. Let's discuss them.
So So do we have money in the budget to come in?
Yes, in the capital building.
In the capital building fund?
Yes, yeah. If I can get it out of the regular budget, I will, but that's where the money will come from.
Yeah, I mean, I'm good with that. I know reading through it, there was a couple in there that, you know, their baseline bids were less. You quickly can see that their add-ons were expensive. So I think it's important. Yes?
Has there been any consideration? There is also work that needs to be done on the town office.
That's on the agenda tonight, too.
Yeah, later on, we'll talk about that.
Okay. I mean, my question is there what conversations have there been or should there be about combining the projects so that town office, town, et cetera, is one complex?
Well, we can't combine them because of the camp of the town office up there. There's just not enough room because of the space. Because part of that lot, there was an, obviously it comes off and then there's the bank. The sand pit was an old landfill up there. So, and they have underground fuel tanks. So they're actually pretty limited on what we can do up there. But yes, I actually have someone go through the town office and I do want to get some work done there. I found out some more stuff about that too. So I actually believe that we should stay where we are. And I think that building was given to the town of Bethel. We've done like two things to it, and really three maybe, and I think it's in a good spot. If we tore out the garage and there's a fire hydrant there we could move, we could actually fill that out a little bit, create a little more parking. But really, people think parking's an issue. It's really not. I mean, for us, we could also try to work with whoever buys the house next door to see if we can park a couple people over there. But I think that, really at tax time, but obviously due to COVID, a lot more people now are mailing their tax bills or just dropping them in the slot after we're closed. But, it doesn't owe us a thing. It doesn't owe us a thing. And even if we were to get rid of it down the road, we need to do some maintenance to it. And I just don't know where we would go. And buying land now, obviously, and then all the development, it's expensive. I think my personal opinion is we'd be better suited to just stay where we are, but do some work to make it work. But
I just want to know if there have been any thought in combining.
There has been,
Yeah, the challenging thing that we've had with that is, as we all know that live here in Bethel, there's very limited land in the village area to do anything with. Either it's in a river corridor or it's a floodplain or it's not feasible. So, and these are the steps that we're taking right now is really that, this would be to have someone come in and say, yes, you can put something here and this is how much it will cost you. Or, no, you can't. And then we're, looking together. In the meantime, we've kind of, over the last year, we've talked about it as a board of, we can't, even though both of these are needed kind of now, to make it cost worthy for the taxpayers of the town, we can't do all the projects at the same time. So we've identified the highway garage as being the first priority. The first priority first priority was the water, which we're doing now. The town highway, we'll call it a shed, garage.
Should be more faster.
What do you think, Doug? What's the proper pronoun? It's not, so that is getting our attention right now. And then what we'll be talking about, which we've been talking about here for months or half a year now, is if we go and do something with the garage, what do we need to put into the office to get us through the next 10 years or so until we can make a decision on, do we keep the office, do we go somewhere else, do we add on maybe the,
But we have been talking about it.
So this is just really just the exploration phase of can we build something there?
Yeah.
And we have a steel structure, so would it be cheaper to just kind of keep the structure and add on to that? Of course, it's kind of like, as we're finding out, it's kind of like putting vinyl siding on your house. Like, you put vinyl siding on, and then 10 years later, when you need to fix it, they don't make that vinyl siding anymore. So, and the steel structure is kind of the same way.
Exactly.
That manufacturer doesn't do it anymore, and they need to find somebody else.
I know, I did put the new roof in.
Yeah, same thing.
Exactly.
Yeah, same thing.
So we're hoping that, you know, we're thinking we might be able to save as much as $30 a square foot if we can reuse that steel, that concrete, and all that, so.
I mean, we had done a, study, what was it, three or four years ago. We estimated up there about $500,000 just to build a, call it a basic facility.
Right.
From scratch, not knowing what there is for underlying issues there, so it could be more. Where, you know, trying to take advantage of the steel structure would be drastically cheaper.
And we know that Chelsea just built a new town garage for $1 million, and we just don't have $1 million. So if we can redo that structure, reuse some of it, and make it up to code and stuff, we'll be good.
And the town hall's been looked at for 30 years.
Excuse me?
The town hall's been looked at for what we could do down there for 30 years.
Right, yeah. True enough.
I mean, I guess I'm more to go with Teresa's direction.
The add-ons are what's going to make the other bids not low anymore.
Well, yeah, I mean, you had one of the bids who had, it was really the base bid, and I, you know, didn't really include anything else, so if you were going to get more services, you're going to have to go to them, and who knows what that's going to be. And there was three of them in there that had a base bid and pretty exorbitant
add-ons.
You know, so if we need to do any extra, it was probably going to cost us quite a bit. You know, child's engineering kind of, I guess, is kind of right in the middle.
Well, he's definitely not the
highest. He's higher than his debt, you know.
He's lower than the GPI, but I feel like you're just going to get more service, and I think we need more than, I explained the proposal to everybody. So everybody got the same proposal, everybody got the same tour, and he just came out with, I feel like, for his money, we're going to get a little bit more information, and information is power. Just know that's going to help us move forward with the design build RFP, so.
It looks like he could have it completed by the end of the month,
yeah.
The end of October.
Yeah, that might help give us
some direction towards budget.
Yeah,
you know, and conversations
as I said, I disclosed that I have worked with Carl before in another town, and on two occasions, and he was great.
Well, it was funny because how it printed off, I had the Child's engineering proposal, and then on another page I had an email that said to Therese from Carl, and I thought we were talking about Carl. So it ended up like, that's crazy.
Yeah.
Carl had the
yeah.
plans to the highway garage.
No, I
was reading that. I was trying to figure that out.
Yeah, no, it was just an example of the fact that he things he had already done. He got the RFP, and then he'd gone this mm-hmm. extra mile by saying, hey, this is what it is, this is who they are, this is what you got. So, anyways.
Okay.
Saying any of this, I don't know if I would have said I had a leaning towards Child, but I definitely noticed the proposal was more comprehensive, and the add-ons on the others were sort of sticking out of like, huh, I wonder how likely it is we'll hit those add-ons and then end up you know, we could select the lowest bid but end up actually paying more, whereas I like that in a way that he did it as like, this is the limit, no add-ons as an option, it won't exceed this, which, you know, gives us a better ballpark in some ways than going with some of the ones with all the add-ons.
So do I hear a motion to use Childs Engineering to do the structural engineering piece of that? We'll have the, what was the exact number?
3,500, not to exceed.
Oh, not to exceed.
3,500.
So not to exceed 3,500.
Right. Mm-hmm. So moved.
Second.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All right. And then this was kind of a continuing talk from the last board meeting. We were talking about the creation of an advisory committee.
Yep. So as you can see, Jesse and everybody, and I say Jesse just because he was here, but everybody else assigned it, did what you asked them to do, which was to come in and basically give a mission statement and write a little bit about, you know, what they wanted to do. And then I was emailing with Jesse, and we had come up with a nice mission statement. I think it was just me. I don't know who mentioned it. So it was Jesse. And it says, the Committee on Inclusion and Equity will be tasked with understanding issues of inequality in our community, suggesting ideas on how to remedy those issues, increasing civic engagement, and offering education and training on how to foster a more inclusive community for everyone. I know that in a follow-up letter email from Owen, and maybe it was not appointing everybody that was on the letter just yet, but having maybe starting the committee, but as having people submit a letter of interest, just like they would, just like Gene did, kind of tell you a little bit about themselves, why they want to join, that sort of thing. I think that was your comment, right, Owen? And, but, so that was it. I think it's a great idea.
Sorry, I'm trying to find my paperwork. Someone likes to print it two-sided, and once in a while, half of it goes one way, and I'm digging through the pile trying to find the other half. So I had written some notes, and I was trying to find.
I don't see Jesse's mission statement.
Oh, and I did will say, I'm sorry, on the letter two that they submitted, I did make a note that the PC made these adjustments.
Right.
So already when they came to the town plan, or the planning commission's public hearing on the town plan, we worked together as a group and came up with some suggestions, and Laura sent me some great information. So we incorporated those changes. So despite the letter saying that, I wrote my little note that says, PC already made these adjustments. So thank you for that. I thought it was a nice cooperative way to work together to get the wording right. So we did that. So just so you know, you didn't have to do that. We made those adjustments at the PC meeting.
So do we have something that we can give them that describes the responsibilities of a committee and the,
sure.
and the structure
yeah,
and the...
Sure. My plan was to obviously do the, and we emailed, this is obviously the mission statement, so they know,
mm-hmm.
and, but we can write that up anyways, give them the information on how to pick a night, pick a time, get the location, give them all the, sit down with them, my plan was to go to their first meeting, and to help them get organized, and just said, you know, you need to pick a chair, you need to pick someone's going to take the minutes and go over the open meeting law. I'm just kind of do like an organizational meeting with them the first time that they meet.
Good.
So yeah. That was kind of my plan. I figured that would be helpful for a committee that's new.
Yeah.
So that was my thought. And then you're going to have another role.
And I know kind of organizing a committee in the past, you have to be careful of the size of the committee too, most of the time in this town we're talking about trying to get people to be on the committees,
right.
But in some cases the size of the committee, you know, if you get, I'm trying to remember what the, it used to be an old saying, I think it was like over just becomes more not as productive, meaning, you know, the more people you have over a certain number. I thought maybe it was six or something.
And there's
five. I thought
not to say that you have to have a certain number.
An odd number is good, because then if you have it in a case of a ties or anything like that on decisions, and you've got an odd number.
And like, for example, like right now, the Planning Commission could have a minimum of three, but it currently just has two, just Gene and I. And, but we could have up to nine by state statute. But, you know, basically you want to find the right field. But it'll depend on how many people, you know, what you're going to be looking for is people who actually can commit the time. And the other thing is, too, is maybe you have someone who can't come to the meetings regularly, but could do something else on the side for you, or, you know, help in some other way. The fundraising, or what, to help write grants, you know, that sort of thing. And I would explain all that process to an organizational meeting. So you guys just need to decide. And it's not really going to depend on how many people put in letters of interest, right? Whether, you know.
So typically what we ask for is, you know, for a committee member to be an official member is, you know, a year commitment. So, you know, they're on for a year, and then after that, you know, they can re-up or get off. We do typically ask, like, you know, this evening is, you know, some sort of formal correspondence saying that I'm interested. Because we have had in the past individuals that didn't know they signed up for something, and then they found out about that afterwards. And you're trying to reverse it because it becomes formal, and we have it in the minutes, and, you know.
Do we want to stagger?
Well, some people, I was just going to say, some
stagger
things,
terms,
some,
so that you don't have everybody, you know, jumping off.
You have several committees that don't have any terms. Yeah. But that's, I think, something we could talk about at an organizational meeting, is you want to have terms, so we can help stagger them. So that would be one of the things we could talk about at the first meeting, is to, and then once they get organized, they can kind of just write a little down on the board, like, hey, this is what we decided, this is how we're going to organize, and this is who's going to be the chair, and all that. So you know, you need once a month,
and then keep in mind of all the other meetings and committees that are going on. So, I mean, it's kind of like, you know, there's school board. I mean, there's different pieces of the, you know, community that's not necessarily the town related, you know. I know it's challenging because certain people might have a certain day of the week that they're free. But usually the Wednesdays are, there's a lot of meetings on Wednesdays.
I feel like
Mondays.
Tuesdays and Thursdays are DRB, so it really depends. But if you look at the website, you can kind of see when everybody, you know, what day they meet. Like right now, the Conservation Commission has been meeting at Peabody Park, but eventually they'll come inside. Some people were meeting at the town office, but now we're just down to one committee or two that really meet there, because it's hard to social distance because it's so small. A lot of people are meeting here. There's also a conference room downstairs too, so we can work it out. I mean, I'm sure we'll find a place for you. And I know the Tramp BRTS board actually met one night at the White Church.
Right.
So,
that was a rare occasion.
Yeah, because some, I don't know who was here. I can't tell if he's here, but anyways. But yeah, so we'll find. We'll figure it out.
So, yeah, I mean, the membership of a committee is tricky. I mean, usually it's just trying to get the numbers. But if you have the numbers, then it's kind of more, you know, picking, you know, individuals that are going to, because you got to think as a committee, especially if you're the chair, right? It all comes down to you. So, you know, evenly spread out the work with people that are motivated to help you with the functions of it.
And have a good diverse membership. You know, some people are strong in one area, some people are strong in other areas, kind of have a mix. Not everybody's, you know, following the same path. You know, have a good discussions, lively discussions with controversy. I mean, we don't always agree. You know, it's good to have the discussions. And
I know one thing that I'd written some notes down here. So even though one thing I found out in Bethel years ago when I first moved here is, even though it's a small town of Bethel, there are different pockets of the town. So, you know, like for instance, there's, you have like Christian Hill, you have East Bethel, you have Gilead, and they're kind of like little subsets of the same town, but you know, you could talk about one issue and those four different locations will have different information for that or see things differently. So maybe, you know, when you're looking to fill membership, maybe not just, you know, obviously welcoming all groups of people, but also look at that subset of where they come from inside the town, which is kind of cool because, you know, somebody in the downtown might look at something way differently than somebody on, you know, Hoover Hollow Road, you know, when you get off the beaten path. So it's kind of neat how that used to. And I wasn't here back in the heydays. I don't know, maybe some others could tell me, but I used to hear that there was some pretty interesting gatherings or meetings from different sections of the town. And how they view things, but I always thought that was kind of interesting in such a small town of 2,000 people, how we have these little, you know, sub-regions of the town, so.
I think it's true with any town. I mean, you know, you always want to mix those, like, village and, you know, stuff, so. Yeah. But anyway, so since that makes sense for people who want to be on it to submit letters of interest for the select board to appoint them, it seems like if you just make, you can make a motion to create the advisory committee on inclusion and equity with the, you know, based on the mission statement that was laid out. And then people will submit letters, and then the select board will appoint, and then once you get enough together, first organizational meeting, figure it out.
So I guess I was confused on where the, I mean, I read through everything, but where was the specific mission statement?
Right here in the town manager's report.
Okay.
Oh, okay.
Right there.
Which is the, well, it's...
It says it.
Right, which is also the same piece from that.
Yeah, it's a little different. Yeah, you know, we changed, we worked back and forth and changed the language, but that's what we agreed on. So I think a motion to start the committee is, would be great, and then we'll go from there.
The other thing I just wanted to throw out there too is, and we've talked about it at other committees as well, it's always good to try to get the school involved as well. And granted, it's, you know, in the past we've kind of looked for maybe, well, it's harder now that we don't have the high school here, but, you know, it used to be trying to find active members in the school at an upper level grade because they're a little more responsible and can help out and things like that. But definitely the school is a good resource as well. So, question?
Laura Perez, and I just have a question regarding the criteria that the select board would use in appointing members to the committee. I could just submit a letter.
No, there's really no...
The past has been more body.
For the most part, it's just a formality of making sure that, one, that a person has interest in it. So that's why we've kind of done like the letter with the person of interest so that we make sure that that person is interested in the position. I think the only time, and it hasn't been yet when I've been here, but maybe if the group was getting too large, you know, maybe that if that ever happens, but, you know, if it was a very large group and it's like, oh, geez, you know, this is your 15th member, you know, maybe that's never happened, but I mean, that would be probably the only thing. The only other thing that we have done recently is because we have some of the membership has been low, like the energy committee. We just appointed two energy committee members that are from outside the community. So it's more of an informational for the board to know, not really like who the person is that's going on and are they qualified, because that's not really, you know, if you have an interest in it, then you qualify, right? But it's more just, you know, are you from the community is like the biggest thing usually. And did you approve of wanting to be, you know, so those are kind of the main things.
It's also nice for the board to put a name to a face.
Yep. Yes.
Two things. I think that in this particular case, there can and should and ought to be some consideration given to diversity within the committee as it relates to the purpose of the committee. People who maybe have been historically disadvantaged, marginalized,
et cetera, in our culture, I think there is reason to expect that this committee will embody the diversity that it seeks to empower within the community.
Yeah.
And I think the purpose of the committee and its own understanding of how it's constituted should take that into account. And that may be a different kind of diversity than locating in the geographic neighborhoods.
I think
of
in the past we've left that up to the committee to kind of.
So I just want to make that suggestion.
Yeah.
And make it out loud.
Yeah, I mean, until you appoint a chairperson, you know, I guess the biggest thing I would just say is, just make sure that when you are, not accepting members, but getting members, that, you know, that those members are speaking for the mission statement that you've put up there, right? You know, obviously we don't want to exclude any groups of people, making sure, ideally, if perfectly, if, you know, well-rounded, you know, everybody's represented. Now we know that in life, most often, that doesn't happen that way. But, you know, and my guess is probably, you know, just like all the other committees that we started in here, like, I started a vision committee 5 years ago, and it started off great, and then after, like, a couple months, then it was two of us. You know, so, you know, and then it becomes like, onus, you know.
So pick some people in the lab.
Yeah, and it's really, you know, everything's exciting and new when it starts, but, like, you know, this is something that you want to keep going for years to come, not months to come. So just keep that in mind. Yes?
Hey, Andrew Kloski. I have kind of a process question. I wonder if you can give us a kind of brief overview of the way that power and decision-making flows between committee and the rest of the town. So, right, we're hoping to create this committee. They make a decision. So, I guess I'm asking for just an overview of how committees interact with the rest of the town levers and what a committee can accomplish in decisions they make on their own.
Sure. What happens is almost all committees are advisory. So what happens is you have your monthly meetings and you submit your minutes and they go in the Selectboard packet. So the Selectboard, you know, knows what you're working on or whatever, so that's great. And if you have something specific that you want to do one time, a year or two ago, and I think I would like to do that again maybe once COVID is over, is get all the committees together so that everybody knows what everybody is working on. But say you wanted to do something, Andrew, you want to write a grant, you want to work on some specific project or whatever, you talk to me, and then I'd help you whatever I could with the grant or whatever the project was. And you could just come from the Select Board if you want to come monthly or you come every couple of months. Some committees, you know, most committees show up every couple of times a year. And give the Select Board an update. In the meantime, they keep updating by minutes. So no committee other than planning and a couple have actually any authority to do anything. With the Conservation Commission, yeah. But you're all advisory, so you can make recommendations to the board. So say you wanted to change something, you know, you decided that this policy or this process could be better done, then you just say, hey, Teresa, I think we could do this, and then we work together, and you know, maybe it's a new policy, a new ordinance, a new whatever, and then you can bring that idea to the Select Board. They got it back and forth with you, and it's kind of a group effort, and then move from there.
And then sometimes it can go the opposite too. It could be, you know, we've had times where the Select Board might have a project, let's say, and task a committee with that project to take ownership of that. So that, you know, and then, you know, we kind of check on to see how's that project going and where you at, and you know, and bringing that information back to us. So you're just kind of, you know, kind of a subset to the Select Board working on a specific task.
Another way to think about it too is, and I'll use the example of the energy committee in our town. So our state has a big initiative towards alternative energy. And our energy commission is sort of tasked with looking at that, understanding what the state's asking, and then helping the town develop a plan of action that will suit our town. Because the state's plan can't necessarily fit. We're a small town. We can't always do everything the state might want us to be able to do. So they're that sort of go-between between what the state's asking and what the select board will eventually enact in a way, right? You're kind of taking that information, distilling it, thinking about it from the perspective of the town needs, the town's abilities and capacities, and then kind of coming back to the board and saying, okay, here's what the state says, here's what we think, you know, and then helping us make more informed decisions based on the state. So it's kind of, there's multi-tiers that it could be coming from, but that's another perspective to look at it from.
I think that's a great example. But I think it was one of the first organizational brainstorms and stuff. You know, obviously everybody on the committee has some ideas, so maybe you start looking at those ideas and say, okay, well, here's a couple things that we could really focus on. And to, you know, I always want committees to have a goal so that they can actually feel like they've accomplished something instead of just pushing the same off uphill. So, you know, we can talk about all that too.
Well, not to offend anybody, it sounds like we're dancing around some sort of words here, semantics. This committee is going to be inclusive on every level. Race, ethnicity, black, white, Indian, Asian, trans, non-trans, cis, male, female. Is that what we're talking about here? Because nobody's really said that. We've sort of moved around it. I think it needs to be said, so that it can be recorded, that that's what this committee is about. It's going to look different, no offense to anybody. And a lot of committees I've seen in this town in my decade being here. I mean, that's what it's about.
Yeah.
It's about inclusion. That word says it all. Not just in towns, different towns, and bringing the towns of Bethel together, but in bringing a community of diverse people with diverse ideas, diverse backgrounds, born here, not born here, which seems to be very important, that is what this committee is going to try to do.
Sure.
I just wanted to get that said because we're sort of dancing around the world. Sorry,
I just to that point. I'm Owen Daniel McCarter, co-owner of this bar, I guess one of the reasons too that we're thinking about this committee and how we come to this is just as people who live in Bethel, who identify with traditionally marginalized groups in a variety of different we want to be helpful. We want to be supportive to the whole town. We have ideas and things to contribute that we think are valuable and important. Part of what we want to know, I think, is how can we support the select board? How can we support the town in its thinking about racial justice right now in this moment where that is a national, international priority conversation? And how can we help the select board think about that question? Are there things that we could be thinking about as we kind of develop our own agenda and stuff that is really in the spirit of let's all grow and learn together, ask questions, challenge each other. We really want to do that. We want to be a part of this conversation. So I think a question too is not just what this group of folks needs and wants, which is probably all of them. But what do you all need and want from a committee like this so that we can make sure that we're tailoring it to the needs?
And I think sort of similar to my description to Andrew, I would say take exactly what is happening at the national level and also what our state is saying that they're going to do and kind of help us, you know, it's got to be a give and take, help us make better decisions based on what you're learning. You're obviously much more steeped in it than the board is as a whole, and so you're going to bring to us perspectives that we might need to hear that we're not aware of, or things coming out of the nation or the state level that, you know, kind of need to be brought into play in ways that they don't already exist in the town. And I think you're already doing that with, you know, the information you put into the town plan. Like, you're already on that track. There's no part of you that's not on that track, but it's exactly that. It's like tying all these pieces in, and Chris said it earlier too, and I know you're on the task force for the school, but tying in what's happening with our school kids. You know, what are they gonna be learning within their school day that then the town can also be backing up and kind of putting all those pieces together? And I think it's gonna be a lot of factors coming in, and I would sort of imagine that we'll see you a lot more at the beginning of starting a committee, because that is the point. It is to inform us and us to inform you, and kind of have that back and forth. It needs to happen. And so as you're, you know, both in the selecting new members and us appointing them, it's also us knowing who you'd want to appoint. I think like Laura's point is really apt, that somebody could put their name in that maybe has a really counter agenda that could actually be harmful. I mean, we might not know that, right? So I think it's not to say that they don't belong on the committee, but it's the more open and the more communication we're having between all of us, the more we're going to be able to help you guys and vice versa.
There is a state, like I sent the information out to, about they were looking for members too, so it would also be interesting to follow them to see what are they working on. Are they crafting legislation? Like, what are they up to? Because that's always trickle down. So that's always
right.
And I think it would also be good for you to understand what the select board does. You know, what we do, and what, in relationship to the committees, you know, we're kind of overseeing so many different facets. I mean, you hear tonight what we've been talking about. It's everything from coin drops to renovating the town garage. So it's good for you to get an understanding of what we do, so when you bring your ideas and concepts to us, you know what we can do and what we can't do. You know, there are certain things that we don't have the ability to do.
And I'm so happy to go through all that.
Yeah, so it's good to understand that. I have a handbook that's like this thick that you can.
That, I mean, I know, when this came to me, and I have daughters, and I think the first thing that came to me is, like, hope that we, like, there's a lot of influence out there right now. There's influences at all levels, state level, world level, Vermont level. And, you know, Bethel is different than, you know, all the other towns, right? I mean, we're all different somehow, right? And I think what I'm hoping that the committee would do would be, first, you know, kind of, I know it's hard, but try to, like, shun out everything out of Bethel. Like, all that energy that's flowing around, but not in Bethel. And really kind of look at Bethel as itself and say, you know, what really do we have our issues in Bethel? And then how do we make that work? And, you know, and then where are we at hell? Because I just think,
like, a microcosm.
Yeah, I mean, right now, like, you know, Bethel is much different than Burlington, it looks like, right? And, you know, and Vermont is much different than California, it looks like. You know, so there's a lot of influences out there right now, and I really would like to see us, like, really look at the Bethel residents or Bethel community on, you know, with this topic of how can we better build that relationship, that community relationship, you know, together. And how does that look? Not just, and again, I think school is a very important piece of this, but, you know, and I think in some cases, in this committee, to do it right, you kind of almost maybe need to get some people out of their comfort zone that, you know, may not want to be on the committee, so that you have that opinion, that well-rounded opinion in the committee. You know, I think it's probably going to be one of your trickier committees to run, because it's, you know, the topic right now is on every TV station. It's, you know, you can't go, you know, check your phone first thing, it's going to pop up, right? And I would like to see us kind of, you know, you guys take on that, guys and girls, you know, the issues that we have here, not necessarily what is in other areas, and really, how do we make that work here in Bethel, right? And then maybe once we get to work here in Bethel, then we can influence our neighbors, right? You know, like, get that sprawl, you know, of positive behavior.
Right.
Yes.
Again, I'm going to take the name of the vote. Feels like there's a little dancing around the topic. Can you go more into detail on what vibe you want us to avoid? And just like you, I hear there's this topic on the news and on Facebook. What topic are you speaking of?
Well, I don't think I need to go through the topics because they're on every TV station every night. What I'm saying is, what I would like to see, and granted, it's your committee, so you can do, you know, anything that you want with it. But, you know, this is Bethel. Bethel is way different than, I've lived in Bethel 15 years. And, you know, Bethel was different than Windsor, where I grew up. And Windsor was different. You know, so all these places are different. And what I'm just saying is, you know, there's so many outside influencers right now, is let's somehow, if we can, you know, try to block out the influencers and try to just specifically work on Bethel, you know. Because what works somewhere else might not work in Bethel. And what works in Bethel may not work somewhere else. But I think the overall goal from reading the mission statement is, you know, we want to make sure that everybody feels included. And to do that, first we need to figure out why aren't people feeling like they're included in Bethel, right? And now if I pull up a report that says why aren't people feeling included in New Hampshire, that's not going to help us here in Bethel, right? So that's what I'm saying, is just kind of trying to figure out what's happening in Bethel. How can we make that work and go from there? But,
well, how can we figure that out by ignoring the vibe that's going on around here? I've heard national level, I've heard state level, but I've heard nothing about the town level. It's all about the trickle-down effect. Well, the people of the town are looking to the town for that leadership on this topic. Racism, discrimination, bigotry, just ignorance. So you can't ask us to do our job and then ask us to try and like put a bubble around Bethel, because there is no bubble.
That's a good point. Yeah, I thought of that.
I think what you can see from the leadership here in Bethel is that you know, our town is probably going to have one of the first, if not, you know, very few committees that are looking into inclusion and equity, right? I mean, do you know any other towns that are currently doing that? I would probably willing to bet that there's probably not more than less than a half dozen of those in the whole state, you know. So I think that right there just shows the commitment to the local government here in Bethel of, you know, let's open up a committee, let's explore, let's see what, you know, see where we go with this. So
if I might, my guess is the people who will be forming that committee probably need to have some acquaintance with the rules and regulations, but in terms of how they actually carry out that mandate, I think that there are probably people there who know how to do that.
No, I don't think anybody, I'm not saying that you don't, I'm just saying these committees are for Bethel, so we want to start with Bethel residents first, and how we can do that is by, you know, sticking in the Bethel area to start.
And then we'll, to add on to that, just so you all know, after we, in partnership with Russell Williams Records, put on the George Floyd vigil and the Bethel Marching Rally for Black Lives, we had a bunch of volunteers who helped with that, safety volunteers, I don't know, people handing out snacks, masks, thank you cards, all the things to the speakers. We, from that group, we started a listserv that's called Bethel Showing Up for Black Lives, which as of today has 70 members who all live in Bethel, basically. And so to me, that's like, there's some kind of disconnect happening, which I feel like is kind of what you're talking about, is that there's, and from our perspective, it was an overwhelming desire to be talking about these issues from Bethel residents, which actually honestly surprised me as someone that's new to Bethel. I didn't necessarily get that vibe But it's been really heartwarming. And so this idea of starting this committee is really, I think, this group of people trying to figure out how we can merge this energy in the town to prioritize this issue from residents and town departments, and to kind of connect those dots. I agree with Chris that this is the exciting thing for me about this is that I feel like Bethel can really be a model for other towns, and this idea of, like, even though we are a small town with 2,000 people, even though we are in a town that is predominantly white folks, this is still something that we care about, we're still going to prioritize, and there's still work to be done here, and so we can model for Stockbridge, we can model for, you know, all the other towns that this is something that's possible and necessary. And so, yeah, it does feel exciting. Really just centering this work on Bethel, with all the wisdom and knowledge that's coming out of, you know, centuries of struggle.
I think it's great that you have to listen, and like you said, you were surprised, and I think you're right. I think that's really important. There's a disconnect. It's something that, you know, if there is something that we can do to make it better,
none of this would have been possible without all those things that you just talked about. Mm-hmm. None of this has ever come up before without all of those outside influences. So yes, we want to center on Bethel, but we cannot pretend like those things don't matter in this bubble. Mm-hmm. We have to use those things as a catalyst to make Bethel stronger in that area. Not leave it aside and forget it. We have to include it because none of this ever hit the table until we turned on our TV every day. We looked at our phones every day, all day, and there it was. And that's what made all of this possible. That's what's making this conversation possible from where I sit. So that's important to remember, and that in building this committee, which is going to be a part of this broader committee, we're under your umbrella. This committee cannot pretend like that's not an influence, and we have to pull from some of that to make this work for this town. Mm-hmm. And that's something that we have to remember, I believe. Mm-hmm.
Well, I think, so I agree with both what you, Leonard, and what David are saying. I think that's where we are looking to you to be the experts, knowing more than we know, mm-hmm. and coming to us saying, here's what's happening at these different levels, and also being Bethel experts. Mm-hmm. You're Bethel residents, you're citizens mm-hmm. of this town, and so then also coming with that information to then say, we're going to put all these pieces together mm-hmm. and give you some advice as to what the next steps are. I think I also, I appreciate that both of you have sort of called out some of the awkwardness and some of the lack of terminology, mm-hmm. right? And I think that's really important. I think that, I want to say this and I don't want it to be contrary, because it's not, but I think that there's a lot of not saying something because you don't want to say the wrong thing.
Exactly.
And we're all in that boat. I mean, like, I myself will admit that, like, I'm in a deep educational phase and I'm gonna say the wrong thing, I'm gonna offend somebody, I'm gonna do something that I regret. But if we're all in this together and acknowledging that sometimes we can't come up with the right term
yes.
or the right
yes.
set of words to express what we're trying to express, but instead we help each other and figure it out and say, okay, I'm noticing you're struggling to put a set of terms to that. Can I give you some and
mm-hmm.
you tell me if they're the right
mm-hmm.
thing? And like and instead work kind of together
yeah,
to find
exactly.
those, because I think you both called it out. It was totally apt. It was like exactly, yeah, we were dancing around subject matter, but at the same time, we're dancing around it because nobody wants to be offensive.
Oh, yeah,
and nobody wants to, you know, we're all citizens together and working together.
Yeah, that's both ways. You right. know, I'm same here. You know, I have to make sure that my wording is strong, direct, blunt, but not offensive.
Right.
And not derogatory. That's a line to walk. It's not a hard line to walk, it's a line to walk. We have to do that.
And it's okay,
yeah,
in fact, to call each other out on it,
yeah.
But also to turn around and be supportive and say, here's maybe where we're trying to go with this.
Yeah, agreed. Thank you.
I'd also like that, just a comment to sort of generate the select board in considering this and imagining what this committee will, how it will operate, what it will look like. I made this comment as a person who holds very few marginalized identities. I'm Bethel resident, I'm a white, heterosexual, cisgendered man, and sort of to build on what Leonard was saying and touch on sort of Chris, your feedback that you've been giving, my understanding as a holder of those identities of this committee that would be made up of individuals who live in this town with intersecting differential identities that are oppressed and marginalized is that they're going to bring their personal stories and understanding of the town of Bethel to make the town of Bethel better for everybody, including the cis hetero white men like me, right? So their purpose, I think, is maybe what I'm hearing in some of your feedback is a concern of oppositional ideology or viewpoint in town, and what this committee is going to do, what it seeks to do, is to make this town better for everybody. And not just, and nothing else.
So does somebody want to propose a motion to create the advisory committee for inclusion and equity?
Second.
David?
Aye.
Aye. And then we weren't going to vote in the members.
No, because all of us were saying, all of us saying was he wanted both the process where people could put in letters of interest and the select board. So I think what's going to happen is people put in your letters of interest. We have another meeting in 2 weeks. And then at least we could get a base of people together and pointed. And then I
tool for when you're putting this committee together on the formality end of things, like she can get educated on that.
Yeah, we'll have an organizational meeting, like I said. So in 2 weeks, we're going to have another meeting, so get your few people in so we can start with
the other people. I don't want people to trees together.
Yeah, trees together. Yeah, you and me. It's like it's me and I, we'll be all
maybe you had to say that.
That's right. Yeah.
Yeah, Dave.
I think
probably needed in 41-day any change to happen for people to get on board. We have to know what's happening. Like I said, I've been here for 60 years and pretty much everything I've heard, I never heard of before. Never saw it. So, why? Well, I live back on the hill, for one. But you think that some reaches, some of these things never. So I guess my comment is, if we have 4 years to try to change it, is to come up with the education of what is going on.
Let us know that there are 70 people in Bethel interested in this subject. So
fascia, the siding, the porch is a problem, and because, you know, it needs to be, the porch needs to be plastic, because anybody who knows, when the state truck goes by, it sometimes it freezes up our windows because it splashes the slush all the way up on the porch. So there is still a huge tank in the basement, or like if there was like a garage area, there's actually still a tank from the creamery under that thing. There's a little building next door that's concrete that you won't pay me enough money to even go near. I won't even, sir, I'm not going near it. And so Tim Mills is there right there. He'd like to move that hydrant, in which case take out that building. You go check it out, let me know what's in there. And if we did that, we could also build that bank back a little bit. So I realized the home wasn't built in a day, but I wanted to at least see and have Dave put some estimates and numbers to it to say, okay, there's some problems. But it's a good location for us, I think. People can walk to it from town. They don't like to, but they can. It's not that far. I've walked it in town before. But I just feel like as we're creating this capital plan for the road, you know, for the garage, I need to use this data and put this in to build it. But I have to say, if we're going to do the roof, you know, which obviously has to be done, even if we get materials, we've got to do the fascia and the soffit next year. And I'm not sure why, you know, should we do the siding at the same time, or, you know, we're going to have a can of worms here, but I'm hoping that once we get a number on the town garage, that we'll have a better idea of where we stand. And maybe we do it in pieces, but the roof is not going to wait. I actually have to get it patched, the holes patched, at least for the winter. Because right now, you know, the water comes out, the porch actually leaks. There's a light bulb that can go on the porch, but I don't put it in there because water runs out there. And so I'm going to be stupid, but not that stupid. I've got to stand up and get electricity. Screw the light bulb, the water's coming out. So anyways, I just wanted the select board to see, to have somebody who's a professional go through that building and lay it out for you as to, you know. But I think it's worth putting some money into it because, you know, you put a roof on 10 and 9 and then you built the town manager's office, like that section used to be able to just open the door and go right to the basement. So you really have to put, you know, there's asbestos tile on the floor, which as long as we don't disturb it, it's no big deal, we go over it. But it needs care and it hasn't been given any.
That's been the problem, there's been no maintenance to the building for
absolutely
years. You know.
Absolutely right, Mom. Absolutely.
Is there any grant money available for weatherization?
Maybe. We may be able to get some grant money for weatherization. That I can look into. But we do the other stuff now. Right? You know, the only thing we can get grant money for the building is a salt shed.
Little building for salt shed.
Efficiency Vermont, and that's a great idea. I'll call somebody tomorrow and get Efficiency Vermont in there because there's some sort of rebates. But
I don't know if there's anything special for the municipal leagues or
I don't know.
Just all
probably home. All the same, but I can ask. But I can also
he said no.
Yeah.
So between now and the end of our current budget season, what are you thinking that we need for minimal?
Well, I know that I'm going to need, you know, money to insulate. We already had kind of said we could do that. We would take that out of the capital fund to do the insulation of the basement. So as long for this winter, I really just want to get the door, an actual door on the basement, so that the snow doesn't come in. Put a little concrete there so that the water doesn't also come in, and get it insulated. So, and I think part of the suggestion was to take the glass out and just put concrete block and then insulate it.
Right.
And we can patch some of the holes. So, I just need to at least get that done so that the heat somewhat stays in the building and it's a little bit warmer. And on Dietrich's office, we're going to take where the outside, inside the garage, and we're going to screw some blue board to the wall, at least temporarily, just to make her office a little bit warmer. Yeah. So, I'm just trying to save a little energy and stuff. But I think as we work on the capital plans for town report, I will certainly, you know, look at this, and by then hopefully have back in the number for the town garage and to see what we can afford. But anyway, so yeah.
It's a lot more Foster your task with finding a stray cat and drop it off at the office as soon as possible.
No problem.
So, yeah. Well, he can come and go as he pleases.
And this is the only time you're allowed to pick up that stray cat. Last time you didn't pick up that. Last time he's like, I got a cat, what do you want to do with it?
So I'll have more information for you on the roof, because I just tonight, I just found tonight just on the warranty and sent an email, so at least we'll get it patched and we'll see how long it's going to take these people to stand behind their roof warranty. But so there it is, it's ugly and it's long, and but
so we got $25,000
to do
basement. I'm mad enough that you've got this here for the basement.
Yeah, we do, because we have the capital building fund, so yeah, we do. And I have a bid currently on the insulation, but I need to obviously I'm going to put out a bid for some more commercial insulators and see if we can get a better price. But yeah, we do have a capital fund. But so this means that my husband will never offer to do a favor like that. That's what I'm thinking about this, maybe. He's like,
is he going to donate his labor for the repairs?
Yeah, right. I said that to him. I'm like, well, you know, he's like, don't people. He's like, no way. But anyway, it was time enough to go through the whole thing. I felt like it was thorough enough because I knew there was so many things wrong with it, but I just needed some of those expertise to kind of put together. So
I think you did a good job.
Yeah,
yeah, very thorough. Very thorough.
Also, no money, but most said you need to pass down the back. So.
Attaboy.
Yep.
Attaboy.
That's right.
He can have all the common time he wants.
That's right.
He's got to build it.
That's right.
All the common time.
Yeah. I'll give him some of mine.
Yeah, don't make
him up. Have all mine.
That's right.
No, David just came in with 1,000 hours of comp time.
Yeah, exactly. So anyways, I'll keep you posted on the roof and certainly the insulation. But
lovely.
I know, not good news, but hey, at least it's spelled out and not working, right?
If it had been done over the years, it wouldn't be the problem.
It's true. You know what, well, town I came from before, it was the same thing. And even when I remember looking at the school, the first thing everybody cuts is building maintenance. I had to build a new fire station. I had to redo the town hall. Holly Hall, which is an old church that the Historical Society used. I mean, they didn't maintain anything. It was how they cut the tax rate low, which is exactly what Bethel has done. If you don't fix anything, you spend any money or put it aside to fix it in the future and you let it go to pot, then you saved all that money right then and there. So,
kick the can.
Kind of where you're at, but.
Yeah.
So.
Okay. So then at budget time, we can look a little more.
Yeah, and I'll reach out.
How we plan on going forward to address those? Because, yeah, you know, we did talk about that. Where to move forward with the highway.
Garage.
New highway garage or renovations of it. What we do is, you know, that we have to make the town office feasible for the next 10 or 15 years, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. You said you weren't on the roof floor?
Yeah, I just found it today. I was looking for it. I just found it just before I came here. It's actually a 35-year, not fully. It's a metal.
Yeah, but not
for labor.
Not for labor. Labor was a year.
It looked to me like it was not properly installed.
Yeah, and we only had a 1-year warranty on labor, so, and it was all nice, so.
They've had people come in and look at that because of the leaking on the deck.
Yeah.
And, oh, that's not a roof problem.
When he was up there, he sent me photos, and you can see there's weird, like, little holes in it, and he said that obviously the heat escaping the building couldn't help those at all.
Right.
Yeah, and then last time we had talked about the purchase of a used cruiser in Norwich.
And so that's in here. You can see I gave you an email from Oscar because you asked some questions, and feels he could probably sell an existing cruiser for $5,000. We know we can buy one for like $10,000. And he does tell you on here that about what's this wrong, that he said the rear suspension and there's a good chance of the wheel bearings may also need replacement. So he's saying that, you know, you could spend up to $1,900 to $2,000. Then the front brakes will need to be replaced at around $400 to $500. The water pump is a potential issue. And that's not an easy job because then it's gonna be the time, you know, the time the belt has to be down. So if you add all that stuff up, you know, you're looking at almost $5,000 in repairs. So
a couple of questions that was kicking out last night. One of the questions was, you know, basically, did we buy the same age vehicle that we have now? And then the second one was, if we did purchase that vehicle from Norwich for, I don't know, whatever it was, $10,000, whatever it was, what else would we need to, you know, upfit that, or is it anything else? Because, like, last time when we retired the Tahoe, which I know everybody in town was sad to see the Tahoe go, but the Tahoe was so out of date that we had to put all, you know, new hardware, and it went from a, what did we buy that, $7,500, I think we bought yours for?
Yeah.
But by the time we upfitted it, it was like $13,000 or $14,000, you know?
Okay. So the upfitting question is no.
Okay.
It's coming with an updated Raptor radar, which itself is a custom radar unit that we use to do speed enforcement. That's newer than the system that I'm using. It's coming with a newer digital ally video recording system, which I don't have to burn DVDs. It's burned on an SD drive. It's fully equipped with a siren. Comes with a, one thing I'll have to do is transfer a radio, but upfitting costs, it's nothing because I can do it myself.
Is there anything mechanically on that vehicle that brings tires?
Well, tires. I can't. It's tires. I'm gonna need winter tires. I'm gonna need winter tires anyway. That's without a doubt. And I've got good prices on tires. It's 164 mounted pounds per tire. That's a B-rated snow tire. The tires that are on the Norwich vehicle will come off from winter. That's the really the upfit that I can think of. There's really no out-of-pocket expense that I can foresee.
And what are you thinking? I mean, I know that this one is, you know, relatively the same age as the current cruiser, but what are you thinking the longevity of this vehicle would be for us? Because, you know, right now, as you know, that we're, what is it, 3 to 5 years?
Yeah,
closer to five.
We're
5 years
we're
is kind of what we...
5,000 a year.
You know,
yeah.
I mean, it could be replaced in 3 years, but, you know, three to five is kind of the...
So this cruiser now has 115,000 on it. This cruiser that I'm looking at has 77,000 on it. It's been kept up. There's no suspension issues. Yes, it's a 2013, but it's in better shape than the cruiser that I've got now as far as suspension. And the body is decent. It is a Vermont car. Most cruisers are Vermont cruisers. This has been kept up and clean. I did get underneath and look. I didn't see any rust. I did get the opportunity to drive on the interstate. The handle's nice. I think what you're getting is when you take into effect the outfitting later down the road to replace this one when it dies, you're going to cost a ton more and longer. I hope they answered your question.
Well, I guess the way I look at it is if we invest $10,000 into this, and, you know, let's say maybe we get back, you know, $3,000, $4,000, or $5,000 for our one that we have now. But is our $5,000 or $6,000 investment right now going to be worth it, being the same age? Will that get us a minimum of, let's say, 3 years?
I think you get three to four years out of, maybe even 5 years out of this, out of the first. How many years have you had this cruiser?
I think this is the third.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it's the third.
Mm-hmm. How many miles are on it? Got
a lot less than the Tahoe. Now, if anybody didn't know the Tahoe, we had the only, like, 1992 Tahoe that had literally VHS cassette tape
yeah.
dash system. I mean, it was a relic, really. Had, you know, antique plates on it and the whole nine yards.
You're going to get 3 years out of this one, pretty sure. I can't, I'm never going to give you a guarantee on that. But when it comes to outfitting a new cruiser, you're saving money now than when you are 5 years from now. Because everything in this cruiser is all set, ready to go. Ted, really good. All I got to do is take the normal job to go and control it. Just replace that cruiser in 3 years with new equipment. If you went to an outfit, you're looking at $75 an hour. You're looking at a minimum of a week to 2 weeks of outfitting. So if you take that into effect, your long-term savings now, it's a great deal to get to 2013 with 77,000 miles on it. Because you won't have to outfit this car for 3 or 4 years. If this dies, which I'm hoping it don't, you're going to have to strip all that out and replace it with something else. The DVD system in there, to replace that, The video system out of the box for a watch guard for our meeting. Forgive me for talking brief to everybody. That's the in-dash camera system that we have in our cruisers. That's a $5,000 expenditure out of the box to uninstall. So I'm trying to compensate all that if you just new cruiser from Norwich. If that makes any sense, please forgive me for the brief.
Roughly how many miles do you put on? Have you put on?
In Norwich, for instance, they were only doing like 6,000 miles a year on that thing.
I can't see it from that much.
Right. No, I'm
yeah, I gotta think you're less than that.
Yeah. I think 12,000 was a high number. So I'm just trying to be.
No, I was just in the ballpark for like a good amount of year. Because if that way, it would be 3 years before you got up to the miles on this one. You got
at least. If not more, it needs to be longer for me to reach that.
Right.
And with the two, and working the two areas, I'm not working as many, not getting as many miles on it. Did I answer your question?
Yeah, I mean, at first I was kind of, do we want to buy a, you know, same age vehicle that we have currently, but looking at what the alternatives could be, well, so let's, you know, let's say we didn't do anything right now, we kept our BMW, put a couple $1,000s into it to get it going, and then next year at this time we're going, we need something. And it sounds like to get another vehicle like this, it's gonna, you know, it's gonna be 10, 15,000 easy.
I mean, you got,
you know, and most of the used cruisers that we get, you know, whatever. You know, like the one you have it now came from down in like Bradbury or something.
Windham, I think it was Windham.
Yeah, I mean, and that was kind of driven by
that. Yes.
I guess this one here hasn't been driven.
No.
It looks like the service is good because I took it back to the dealership to call the service.
Yeah.
That's usually better.
It was nice after the car back.
Right.
It's been very well kept, and this one was used and abused. I'm going to say that. That's my humble opinion, being a different cruiser for 20 years. That one's, it's time for that to start to go.
I think the other question that the board members had, and feel free to jump in with, was the other question was, do we buy another cruiser with, you know, currently not knowing the direction that we're going to go with?
That's my
services
question.
Currently. So, you know, with you being over in Worlton for a majority of your time, you know, right now we're either looking at having to pick up another individual or to either split shift with over here,
yeah.
which obviously that person can be the vehicle, or, you know, the other thing that we talked talked about is, which I don't believe we still have gotten any information, maybe you're working on it, but, you know, if we did work out a deal with Royalton came in and did some patrolling and, you know, have that individual on full-time, what does that look like?
They'd need a cruiser.
Yeah, okay.
It would somehow be incorporated. If Royalton would take over the cruiser would become part of that agreement. And that's popular right on top of that. But to do that, you've got to have a cruiser that's more part of the agreement. And this cruiser is worth that agreement. I can't stress that enough. The equipment alone in that cruiser is worth $10,000.
Is it better than what you got for Royalton?
It's comparable. The Raptor radar is a wonderful radar system. The digital allies is a really good video system. It's comfort. Like I said, is you take Norwich off that door and you control it.
Is that a question?
Yeah, I guess I'm just curious as to why you need better equipment than the world to use the
I'm just figuratively saying that. It's all equipment. If I were to make a comparison between the video system and this system that I got now, this system runs concurrent DVDs. This other system runs is just completely digital.
Right, but once the Royalton Department takes over, if that's what happens, wouldn't it then be their responsibility to upgrade the department that they just picked up?
Probably not.
It depends on the agreement. Every time we contract out, there's different things that can come to play, and we just scratched the surface of the possibility of doing this. I also reached out to the VST about contracting, and we didn't have a constable, and you know, we would do some stuff, so we're still super early in the game, David, how that agreement would look right now, I don't know. At this point, we're just moving forward with the fact that we have a constable, and that's how we're doing it right now. Just kind of sticking with that. We don't know what it's going to turn out to be.
And we've been exploring all of our, you know, and we've done this before Oscar came, when Mark retired and then came back under the forces under the name. But when he was going to retire, you know, we did our due diligence just like we would with anything. Look at, you know, what does Windsor County have to offer? What does Vermont State Police? Do we go another constable? We've talked to the townspeople in the past that one of the largest voices from the town, well, voices as a whole, is that, you know, that the town doesn't want to see a police department. So, you know, we want to see a small form of law. In order, which is, you know, been a constable for years in this town, and that's where a large amount of people in the town would like to see it stay. And of course, it's always easier if we always like, oh, maybe we can contract with the sheriff's department, maybe we can contract with Royalton. But then we get the numbers back, we're like, that's not going to work, you know, because they're expensive, you know. Like Windsor County, we tried that thing years ago, and they were like 5 times what we had budgeted, you know, so it was, you know, very expensive. And then, you know, sometimes when you get like a sheriff's department, you don't get that community feel either. You know, it's an identity that's not from the town that comes in and does a little bit of, enforcement and then leaves. The other thing we also have to look at in our town is it's more than just, speed enforcement and local law enforcement. It's also the animal end of it. Because if you don't, you know, we could contract with, you know, Royalton or with the sheriff's department. They may say, well, I'm sorry, but we're not going to pick up the animal control and all that. So then we would have to either hire somebody to do the animal control or appoint somebody to do the animal control. So it's a very convoluted web of stuff at the local level.
And I mean, on the animal control issue, I don't have a cage. So the pooches and the animals, they ride in the back. And sometimes I get my ears in. So, that case is wonderful.
Yes, sir.
So just out of curiosity, did I understand that right the last time that Oscar, your term is expiring eventually soon?
No.
Okay.
So, expiring.
No. Okay, but you said the term was up and you were thinking about Royalton, so how long, much longer?
Well, what happened was, so we typically, we have a constable in this town, or we have had a constable in this town for quite some time. And we do, it's kind of, I guess you would say part-time. So it's 20 hours a week of patrol time. And so that's the way we've done it. And Oscar recently, a few months ago, the town of Royalton had expanded their police force over there. So Oscar has gone over there, we'll call it more full-time-ish, over there. And he right now is only running like half of what we normally would like him to do here. So the conversation at this point has been, you know, do we hire another constable to pick up those 20 hours? Do we hire another constable just to pick up the amount that Oscar's not picking up? Or do we, like, we started looking like, you know, Vermont State Police, could they do it for us? Sheriff's Department, and now what we've talked about is means that Royalton has an extra patrol person over there. Maybe we could contract with them to come in and do some of the local patrolling. So those are kind of the options that we have. Of course, right now we're dealing with a vehicle that it's kind of like really going to do something with it because we're going to dump some money in it, and then the fear is that we put money in it, and a year from now we're like, we've got to put more money in it.
Correct.
And a good deal has come across with a vehicle that's in good shape. Do we pull the trigger on it? Likelihood is that even if we get the vehicle, one or two things are going to happen. Either we're going to hire a supplement to Oscar to help out doing constable, or Royalton takes it over, which they would take the vehicle. So at this point, it's all, you know, almost kind of a foolproof get the vehicle thing. Because we're going to need it one way or the other.
Yes.
And if we even went, if for some reason, which I did not at this point to happen now, but PSP is, if we would sell a cruiser to somebody, we need to look that. But right now, they're shorthanded and they have a hard time showing their own time, so they're kind of not in this right now.
We're pretty fortunate with our community because, Vermont State Police are literally right down the road, so they do a lot of, not scheduled, but they did do a lot of patrolling for us at times. But again, can't pick up the phone to them and come get the stray dog that's running down the road, or
if you want to call me and talk to me about something, my number is always available.
And here in town, for many years, we had some Vermont State Police officers that actually lived in the community here. So that was always kind of an extra benefit of when in doubt, we could call that person up and they would, take care of things for us. That, we don't really have that as much anymore. With some retiring and moving out and stuff like that. So,
I think it's almost like these two conversations we're having tonight are really. This is an opportunity, I think, for us to take a pause for the cause. What I know is that I don't feel safer around the presence of people that are in uniform, period. I can't speak for anyone else, but I know that is something that I would be really interested in thinking about long term. I know this is not an immediate conversation, but just what are ways that we can meet the needs of what you do offer? In our town, including animal control and, seeing things like that, without putting more of our very limited financial resources into policing. And I think that's something that, is part of the conversation that we're having before, is that there are voices that have not really been heard super well in this town for a number of reasons. And I know just anecdotally talking specifically to Black folks in our community and in our surrounding communities that, having, police flashers in front of the school, the kids are getting out of elementary school, and, just some of the optics of this is not really, the optics and the reality of this is not necessarily something everybody's really in support of. And so I wonder if it's almost an opportunity for us to kind of take a breath together and be like, who are people in our town that we haven't heard from about this? Can we make sure they're in this sort of a broader question. And I think there's some really exciting ways, especially in Bethel, where we really show up for our neighbors, you know? Like, that is something that I love about being here, that I wonder if there are ways that we can leverage the power of our own community to address some of the issues that we're relying on police to address right now, if that makes any sense. And I also think, like, there's funding, right, that could be used in different ways, whether it's for what you were saying, Chris, about, you know, more funding for the school system, thinking about prevention, preventing violence, as opposed to just responding to it. I know that's something that the White River Unified School District has a task force to think about right now. Just if we could have some more time before we invest more money in this to be reflective. It's just where my brain is right now. I don't know if anybody else is thinking that, but it does feel like it's very connected to the
issue of the... You know, thank you. I mean, I will say on our end of things, and the policing of our community anyways, you know, like I was saying before, is that, you know, over the years, you know, the residents of the town have always wanted a constable, well, not grow bigger than a constable.
Mm-hmm.
The constable, right now, a majority, and I'm sure Oscar could touch on it, a majority of the work that he does do when he's around is speed enforcement, which speed enforcement really isn't, you know, we're not talking, you know, he's not knocking on doors for search warrants, he's not doing any of that type of stuff. What he is doing is he's getting the people that are driving 62 miles per hour in front of the school, right? And I think we can all agree that, you know, speeding in front of a school zone is very dangerous. And we had kind of an outcry, it was about 2 years ago, Lynn Lane, of the speed through. It wasn't just through the village, but it was going up Church Street and up to Pleasant Street. Was that right?
Yeah, it was like going up the hill, people would gather.
Especially around the corner of like Pleasant Street, Church Street, like the speed, and then they hit the straightaway. And that's why sometimes you'll see Vermont State Police will sit down by the fire station. And what they really are doing is a school zone, and it's a safe zone. And some other things that we've done to try to help out with speed enforcement for when Oscar isn't here, is we've done the speed board, you know, blinky signs to say this is how fast you're going, you know, slow down type of deal. So the majority of what Oscar does here with us is speed enforcement, animal enforcement, but at the same time, Oscar's credentials are at the point where he's able to help us do more if need be. And some of those services that he's provided with us over the last couple of years, which has been great because he has the full credentials of a police officer. So he has been able to help us with some things like drug issues. We used to have, excuse me, I'm losing voice. We used to have, I'm sure everybody that's been here for a while, we used to have a very ugly, well, I'm sure it's not gone, but a very noticeable, let's say, a very noticeable drug presence right in the downtown area. So, you know, some of that has been indirectly dealt with by having someone like Oscar here. Our constable before really didn't have the power to do any of that work. So that would be more of a handed off to the Vermont State Police, and then, you know, they have five people on duty and they do a very large area, so they don't really have to be able to do the work, you know. So I just wanted to just make sure everybody knew what Oscar's duties are here in the town versus what we call a full-time police department. So any of the things like, I mean, Oscar will respond or help Vermont State
medical,
Police.
Do medical responses, I do a lot of passive deterrence, community outreach, do a lot of the schools.
And that's another good point that Oscar's pointing out. You know, a lot of us don't realize, but when somebody has a medical emergency at home, the majority of the time, the first responder at that home is the police officer. It's not the ambulance. You know, the police officer is the one that starts first aid while they're waiting for that. So, you know, those are all kind of important things.
The other thing too to keep in mind is that, you know, the town does weigh in on the fact that we have police service every year at town meeting when they vote on the budget, because that budget is part of the general fund and can always be discussed, just like every other, you know, budget. We do roads and everything
right.
else. So certainly, the Bethel residents have made a referendum on wanting some coverage over the past because they approve that budget every year at town meeting.
Yeah, I think that was the original decision at town meeting, that we were going to have a particular type of a constable, you know, and what they were going to do and what kind of hours, and that was a town meeting decision.
Yeah, because I think it, because the difference between constables, that if you're a constable, like Mark was a constable, which means, you know, you just have to go to like a part-time academy, you have to have a little bit of training. Oscar's a 2E, which means he has, you know, he can't do death investigations, but he can do just about everything else. So there's different training for police officers. So certainly when Oscar came, it was a step up in the best way. He brought with him child seat inspection and all that sort of thing. So, but the residents have voted every year to approve that budget, so by that case, it's saying they want coverage.
And probably in the last 5 years, our budget on the constable end of things is probably almost double, but it's not double to the point where you think like we're getting more. What's happened is there's just so much more policies and procedures that are set down from state and federal levels that, right. Like, you know, for instance, you know, there's a lot of behind the scene work that Oscar has to do. Like if he pulls somebody over for 62 and a 25 in front of the school, if the person wants to go to court about that, then we pay up. Oscar has to go represent us in court for the speeding ticket. You know, it's a lot of that type of things. Or in some of the cases, of, especially if you land in the, you know,
DUI or drugs.
Something to do if you pulled somebody over and the person had drugs. I mean, that's like a whole day's worth of paperwork. You know, so you got 8 hours worth of paperwork that you're paying to do the service. So it's kind of very cumbersome. But I mean, what we're looking at today is, you know, this in our well, I don't want to say capital plan, but what we've been doing in the town over the last 3 years mostly is, you know, we've started these different funds so that we can have money appropriated for you know, cruiser fund, capital funds, or these funds that we have available, so that if we need to replace something, that we don't have to go to the voters and say, okay, we need $10,000 this year. You know, this is money that we've started appropriating a couple of years ago, so we have that, and then when we so that we can take advantage of that when we find a good deal.
And they did approve a capital cruiser plan, the voters, because we did approve to start that and fund that and schedule, and it was also in the town report last year. And and this is the second time this has been on the agenda. They tabled it last time, and so it's this is switched back.
I think something that
impacts us locally, even though it doesn't seem like it should. And this is an illustration of some people feeling less comfortable or even fearful with police, and police feeling that they're under attack by a population that whatever. So this is a classic example of the kind of conversation that needs to happen, and with all due respect, it may be that in some cases it may not be best to have law enforcement in uniform in the school doing the drug education, because there will be some in those schools who are having, or in families who have to have the talk, and for whom the blue and the guns and all of that kind of stuff represents something entirely beyond and outside of my experience. But so that's a, well, good to hear the difference between a constable and police, but the physical appearance isn't different. And so it's also good to hear that for everybody it's not the same comforting experience. And you're gonna be, your anxiety goes up as well.
Well, it sounds like that I think you found your first member on your group.
Yeah.
Who was the first member? I mean when we're talking about inclusion and equity and in our current worldwide and regional, and we're reaching out to somebody like Oscar to be a part of the group to talk about some of these things might be good. I just want to get back onto the topic that we have tonight, which is right now is we've been saving money for 3 years for our cruiser. The cruiser does need some work. We could, the question on the table is, do we invest some money into the cruiser in hopes that it lasts us for a few more years, or do we take advantage of a new cruiser that virtually needs nothing other than tires? We do have the money in our fund. So I guess if somebody wants to make a motion to purchase, and then we can go from there.
So move.
I second that.
Second. So, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Who seconded? I'm sorry.
David.
Okay. Study when I met with Ripple, I asked them to do two things. One is the standard, which is,
you know, like to see you put in the two abutments and the regular concrete bridge deck. And then I talked to Matt Rowski at Ripple and said, no, so if you want to put in another 80 bridge that's maybe 90 feet long, it's just going to be a lot easier to deal with. So that's how it's going to go. I think it's going to change that so you can see that it goes, it's going to sit, you know, beside where the temporary is now. I've tried to then buy the temporary bridge and the state won't sell it to me, so we're just renting it for $150 a month. But the design build that's going to go out. The design build is going to go out. It's to do another maybe bridge, but do it there. So that'll go out design build. So doing that, also working with Aldrich and Elliot and Tim on plans for Crystal Drive and Sand Hill. There actually is some planning money. So they're getting ready to put together a planning grant so that we can do that because we know we need to attack both of those at the same time. I've kind of started doing chop, looking at cost to downsize the road crew and outsource some of that work, but apparently this is just a lot all at once with budget coming, and so we'll get through it. It's just going to take a minute to get through all the stuff that's pending right now.
But it seems like, you know, right now, between now and through winter, we should be able to, with what we currently have and maybe bringing back our seasonal and stuff, should be able to cover all the flowers.
Yeah, that's my plan right now, is I'm just going to bring back a seasonal for now to get us through the winter, because right now it doesn't make sense if we're going to end up keeping more of a skeleton crew and then and outsourcing some of it, then if that's what we end up doing, I don't want to hire somebody right now and then end up saying, oh great, you know, in the spring you're done.
Right.
So that's my plan at this point. Also, as we do not receive any petitions against the dog ordinance or the trash ordinance, so they went into effect on Friday. So, a lot happening at the town office. a lot of things to do. So that's where I stand there. The other thing is obviously in your report is Tim's updates on the water project. There in here. You also had asked for, oh no, I'm going to give this another minute. So, other information, but then there's Tim's update on the water project. The superintendent that was in place, Pete, had left and went for another firm, and so the superintendent now running the job is actually Jay, who was the project manager. But things have picked up, and they actually seem to be making a little bit, you know, more progress, and so things are moving forward.
That's good.
Any activity on the sand? The place that was selling on Sugar Hill?
Not yet, no, I just put it in the paper, so no activity yet.
Do you have any numbers on our lead project, lead
pipe? No, and it won't for a while, it won't tell. So, and as we know, the project is going to go up into next year, so.
But there's some money available for that, even though it's going into next year?
Yes, it's the 100% replacement, yeah. So yes, and we track all that separately.
Anything else? Select board meeting minutes from the 14th of September.
So are we going to discuss the Ford Festival again? Request at some point?
Mm-hmm. It's under communication, so it's up next.
You
said
that
you want a number, so I
can. Oh, yes.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. I thought we were going to make a decision.
Well, that's what I mean. We're going to talk about it.
You asked for information on the
historical cost.
Yeah, the last couple of years of expenses and stuff.
Right.
So that's what I gave you.
Yep.
But,
okay.
Yeah, I'm going to start a factor.
Is there a motion to approve the minutes from September 14th?
Dave, were you happy with that? I got the draft later. I think what Lindsay said. Can you read it better?
Second.
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 Give it to Paul.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
And the other communications here, we have the August financials. Is that good? Anybody have any comments on that?
I just want to say the auditors are here this week and things are good. They are wrapping up the transfer station, and obviously, because we spent over 750.
I did see, when were they going to start bringing in sand to the town? I know they purchased any sand to date.
They have been, they probably set in the bill yet.
Oh, okay.
I was just going to say,
I don't want to say the four-letter word, you know, but eventually that's going to drop.
Yeah, exactly.
We'll be standing before, you know.
I thought you were talking about the poor guy, like, he saw the auditors, and I'm like,
No, on the financial August, I didn't see any cost to sand, so I wondered if we were bringing in, if not, when we were going to do it.
He's hauling, they've been hauling, and Dylan probably said the bill.
Okay.
What?
Well, I mean, this time of year, you're on.
No, I know.
You know, we are, a month ago, then getting over Halloween and snowstorms. So.
They've got the sand pile cleared all up.
I just haven't got a bill. Probably Dylan hasn't, yeah.
See, Randolph's been hauling a lot through town, too.
Yeah.
Randolph?
Oh, yeah. Truck after truck. I don't know where they're getting
it. Is everything up there, highway garage wise, all set for plowing? Is there any issues with anything? All right, and then the Ford Festival financials, everybody's got the history of the cost there, so when we get to the budgeting season, we can talk about that based on the request from last meeting. Mm-hmm. Anything else that we didn't include that we brought up this time, board members?
Thank you.
You're welcome. It's the largest turnout we've had in a long time.
Oh, yeah.
It's very cool.
Very cool.
Usually we're lucky. We're just like trying to get more than two people here. It's tight. You know, it's Lisa. You know, usually Lisa and sometimes Doug. And, you know, that's about... Oh, and Elle.
Sometimes Doug.
Yeah, and Elle. Yeah.
We need to make a motion to adjourn.
Second.
Okay, all in favor?
All right.
Have a good evening, everybody.
Have a good evening.
Thank you.